When I'm all up in your presence and I'm catching all your blessings. Good evening, everyone, at Praise Chapel Revival Oxnard. This is Pastor Johnny Montillo welcoming you to our Wednesday midweek service. I hope and I pray, as always, that tonight's message be an encouragement to you, that you apply tonight's message in your daily walk with Jesus Christ, and that you encounter the Holy Spirit's power in full. As always, before we begin, I want to thank the shepherd of our church, Pastor Mondo Carrillo, and his wife, Sister Veronica Carrillo, for all that they do for the body of Christ. Continue to keep them in your daily prayers always. And in speaking of prayer, let us open up in a brief word of prayer. Father God, we thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, because your word is mighty, powerful, wonderful, and amazing. It reveals your love to us, Father God. And as we dive into your word tonight, I pray, Father God, with expectation, Father God, that you're going to do wonderful and magnificent things in and through your word. Holy Spirit, we surrender tonight's service unto you. And as always, we pray with expectation that lives be set free, restored, transformed, renewed, and delivered. These things we ask in Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Tonight I wanted to talk to you about God's unyielding love. And as we embark into this message that is truly close to my heart, and we're going to talk about God's unfailing love and having that trust in times of doubt and despair, and having that trust in God's love to remain our firm foundation. And as we explore this through a couple of key scriptures tonight, we're going to unpack the application of this and the purpose and the importance of trust and trusting in God's unyielding love. Our first verse comes out of Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. And these are some common scriptures that we all know, but it reads, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." In our daily lives, we should remember that nothing can separate us from God's love. But we don't always feel like that at times. We feel that because of what we've done or because of how we are, that we are separated from God's love. But we're called to live boldly in knowing that God's love sustains us, empowers us, and truly is compassionate to each and every one of us. The purpose of this scripture is to assure believers like you and I that God's love is constant, regardless of the external circumstances, regardless of what's going on. And this truth should motivate us to live in a life that glorifies God and reflects His love to others. God's love gives us a vision of hope and redemption. And as we face life's challenges, we can hold on to the promise that nothing that's going on can separate us from God's love. And ultimately, He will work out things together for our very good. We have to know that God's love is unwavering within our lives. We can place our trust in Him. And this trust, in a sense, enables us to live with confidence, assurance, knowing that God is always with us, guiding and protecting us. And the verses we just read, they present an exceptionally powerful declaration of God's enduring love for His people, His unyielding love for His people. And it paints for us this beautiful picture of how profound and how in-depth His all-encompassing love truly is. His all-encompassing love truly is. That nothing can separate us from it. Not this nor that. Not past nor present, not even the future. Nothing can separate us from God's love. And that's a truth we truly need to embrace and hold on to, because we feel that this or that has separated us from God's love. Yes, there's things that we need to work on that we know if they're not in alignment with the Lord, we need to begin to challenge those things. Because it could truly lead to consequences and circumstances that befall us because of our ways. But here's the fact that remains. His love remains forever. No matter what we're going through, no matter how troubled things are, His love is always there, and nothing can separate us from that love. These verses, they powerfully state that nothing, Neither human experience, spiritual beings, the passage of time, external forces, nor anything else in all creation can sever the bond of love between God and those who are in Christ Jesus. That's key right there. It's an unbreakable, eternal love that transcends all boundaries and circumstances, and that is truly unyielding. Open your Bibles, if you will, to Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. It says, "The Lord appeared to us in the past, saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness." You see, you and I are to receive God's love, allowing it to transform our very lives. As we experience that love, that great love, we can extend it to others, showing kindness and compassion in all our interactions throughout our days. But the key point of this whole entire verse is how the Lord is saying that I've loved you with an everlasting love. A love that lasts. A love that doesn't pass. A love that is always there. It reminds us of the depth and even the amount of God's love. It's an everlasting and unfailing love surpassing all human understanding. We can't explain it. That's what's beautiful about it. And as we meditate on that truth, we have to be filled with gratitude and awe even for the love of our Heavenly Father, that He would love us, even you and I, even in our messes, even in our troubles, He still loves us. God's love allows us to experience unity and reconciliation. When we fully grasp the magnitude of His love, which we can't even really grasp, but when we try to grasp it at times, we are compelled to live in a way that is filled with gratitude because He loves us no matter what. In doing so, that allows us to have that forgiveness in our very own hearts towards others who may have hurt us. That love that empowers us to shower love back to others. God's love is a source of trust and confidence. And as we experience that love, because it's always there, we can trust in His promises and rely on His faithfulness, knowing that He will never let us down. Never let us down. And this trust enables us to walk in faith, knowing that God's love will never fail you and I. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3 is a beautiful expression of God's enduring love for His people. It shows us a love that transcends time and circumstances. It remains constant and unchanging in this way. And it reminds us, as He has said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. It reminds us that God's love is not only present, but it's also eternal. That word everlasting suggests that His love is unending. It's timeless. It's not limited by our understanding of time, space, or even circumstance. Before we existed, God's love was already there, and it will continue on for eternity. That's how deep and how awesome His love is. And I believe that when we read this verse, It should remind us that He's always loved us and He will continue to love us. 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 through 10. And the verse reads, "This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. This is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." This block of scripture reminds us to respond to God's love with humility and full gratitude. See, we're called to live in a way that reflects His love, extending it to others. The purpose of this scripture is to remind us of the sacrificial nature of God's love, that He would sacrifice for you and I. That God would sacrifice, that Christ would sacrifice, and that His love is not based on merit or worthiness, but on His own character and on His compassion. And we have to meditate on that truth, that we could be filled with wonder at the depth of His love. God's love reveals to us redemption and salvation. Through His Son, Jesus Christ, we're reconciled to God, and we can experience the fullness of His love. Love that can never be torn apart. And when we embrace this truth, we can therefore walk in the good news. Because that's the good news, that God would love us and was sacrificed for us and give his very son for us. That's the gospel message. And that his son sacrificed for us his very own body out of love. Out of love. This verse begins by emphasizing that God has shown his love to us. That he showed his love to us. This indicates that he didn't just merely speak about love, but he activated his love. It was tangibly and actively demonstrated for us to see his love in action. See, we may say we love this, we love that, but there's no action behind it at times. But God, when he displays his love, he truly places it into action. He shows his love because he sent his one and only son into the world. God's demonstration, his greatest demonstration of love, is emphasized by sending his very son, Jesus Christ, to be the sacrifice for you and I. And his action, it shows the great extent to which God was willing to go to express his love for humanity. That he would give his very son, that's how much he loves us. How can we not feel loved when we have this evidence here that God sent his only son? He loved us so much that he would send his son to sacrifice and to make that propitiation, to make that sacrifice, to make that restoration. That his love for us was so much that he would send Jesus, his one and only son, has a unique, unparalleled expression of God's very love for you and I, that we might live through him. See, the purpose of God sending his son for you and I out of love was to give us life, and to give us purpose. And this life is not merely a physical existence like we're thinking, but a quality of life. Not just living, but living a life characterized by that spiritual renewal, by that reconciliation, by that redemption that we have with God because he gave his very son. And it happens only because he loved us enough. I say tonight, and I'm going to continue saying it, how could we feel unloved when we know that God gave his very son out of love for us and his son sacrificed out of love for you and I? You see what the verse says? It says, this is love. John stated that this is love. John clarifies that the essence of love is not our initial love for God, but as God's sacrificial love for you and I. It's not that we love God, it's that he loved us enough to do this. This should create great passion within us, reminding us of our value, of our confidence in him, that he loved us first, not that we love God, not that we gave this or that, not that we might do this or that. But our love for God is in response to his love for us. It's not the other way around. Our love for God is in response to his love for us. But he loved us so much that he sent his son as a sacrificial propitiation for you and I. That he would die for us. That he would give for us. That he would love us as we are. Knowing that he sees what we should be and what we need to be. See, the pinnacle of God's love is revealed in sending Jesus as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. The term atoning sacrifice, it's crucial because it basically defines that God's love is not just emotional or sentimental like ours is, but it has a redemptive purpose. Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross was the ultimate expression of God's love for you and I, providing a means for you and I to be reconciled with God and to have eternal life, because God loved us enough that he wanted to have that reconciliation with us. He wanted to eradicate that sin that was blocking us from him. And he did it out of love. And he did it with his very own son. These verses we read in 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 through 10, they reveal God's love as sacrificial, unconditional, and the foundation for yours and I's salvation. It's a love that seeks our well-being, that initiates, if you will, reconciliation, and transforms our very lives. God's love is not contingent upon our actions or our worthiness or what we do, but we are called to love because he loved us. And that love should be able to transform our very own lives, to change us from having that desire to sin, to rather have that desire of gratitude and appreciation for what he's done, and to show love to others, to bear witness to the love that he's shown you and I. Because his love is truly unending. It knows no bounds. And it really is personified by his actions that he didn't need to do for you and I, but that he did because he wanted restoration between him and us. These scriptures that we just studied, they remind us of how deep and how wide God's love is for you and I. That his love is unwavering, it's unyielding, and it truly has the power to transform our lives if we would begin to embrace these truths. Here's the thing I want to say. May you and I live each day in the fullness of his love. May you and I reflect his grace and compassion to all those around us. And may you and I begin to understand that his love knows no bounds. And may we never feel unloved, knowing that God gave for you and I the ultimate sacrifice, his very son. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, because your word reminds us of your unyielding love, your love that nothing can separate us from, your love, Father God, that has always existed, your love, Lord Jesus Christ, that loved us even before we knew what love was, and that it continues, Father God, to build in us assurance and confidence, Father God, in who you are. We thank you, Father God, for showing the ultimate love, the sacrifice of your very son. May we never feel unloved, but may we always know through our identity in and through you, Lord Jesus Christ, you, that we are loved, we are cared for, and more importantly, Lord Jesus Christ, that you loved us when we knew not what it was. We thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, and in your most mighty name we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen, amen, and amen. And tonight's altar moment, I believe there's some of you out there who have been feeling unloved lately, who have been feeling unworthy even at times lately, who have lost their confidence in their identity with the Lord. I believe in this altar moment is a time to understand and to embrace that unyielding love, that you declare during this altar moment, even if you will, that nothing has separated me from the love of Jesus Christ. And that you declare in this altar moment, even if you will, that his love has always existed and nothing can change that. And most importantly, that you declare that you are loved and you are cared for by the Lord because he first loved you before you even knew what love was. Such a beautiful and mighty thing to embrace. Let us pray. Just as I am, you welcome me. With open arms, how can this be? My guilt is undone. My past is untethered. I leave it behind and run to my Father. There is no disappointment in the right.
I am loved, I am loved, I am loved, I am loved.